Sister Citizen, Shame, Stereotypes, and Black Women in America by Melissa V. Harris Perry. Narrated by Lisa Renee Pitts. Copyright 2011 by Melissa Victoria Harris Perry. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with Melissa V. Harris Perry, care of Anderson Literary Management, and was produced in the year 2012 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. The Hurricane. From Their Eyes Were Watching God by Zora Neale Hurston. Zora Neale Hurston was criticized both by her contemporaries and by subsequent generations of scholars for being a romantic elitist disconnected from the substantive concerns of Black Americans. Dismissed as disengaged storytelling in an era that produced serious political commentary about race, Hurston's work was consigned to a footnote of the Harlem Renaissance. But if we read Hurston carefully, we find important political lessons embedded in the story of a Black woman's search for self. Throughout Their Eyes Were Watching God, Hurston reveals how the politics of race and gender intersect the challenges of self-exploration. Together, these forces become a storm, a literal hurricane, in the life of Hurston's main character, Janie Mae Crawford. It woke up old Okeechobee, and the monster began to roll in his bed. Began to roll and complain like a peevish world on a grumble. The folks in the quarters and the people in the big houses further around the shore heard the big lake and wondered. The people felt uncomfortable but safe because there were the sea walls to chain the senseless monster in his bed. The folks let the people do the thinking. If the castle thought themselves secure, the cabins needn't worry. Their decision was already made as always. Chink up your cracks, shiver in your wet beds, and wait on the mercy of the Lord. The boss man might have the thing stopped before morning anyway. It is so easy to be hopeful in the daytime when you can see the things you wish on. But it was night. It stayed night. Night was striding across nothingness with the whole round world in his hands. A big burst of thunder and lightning that trampled over the roof of the house. So Tea Cake and Mota stopped playing. Mota looked up in his angel-looking way and said, "Big Massa draw him chair upstairs." "I'm glad y'all stopped that crap shooting even if it wasn't for money," Janie said. "Old Massa is doing his work right now. Us ought to keep quiet." They huddled closer and stared at the door. They just didn't use another part of their bodies, and they didn't look at anything but the door. The time was past for asking the white folks what to look for through that door. Six eyes were questioning God. Through the screaming wind, they heard things crashing and things hurtling and dashing with unbelievable velocity. A baby rabbit, terror-ridden, squirmed through a hole in the floor and squatted off there in the shadows against the wall, seeming to know that nobody wanted its flesh at such a time. And the lake got madder and madder with only its dikes between them and him. In a little wind lull, Tea Cake touched Janie and said, "I reckon you wish now you had a stayed in your big house, way from such as this, don't you?"
"No."
"No?"
"Yeah, no. People don't die till they time come nohow, don't care where you at. I'm with my husband in a storm, that's all."
"Thank you, ma'am. But supposing you was to die now, you wouldn't get mad at me for dragging you here?"
"No. We've been together around 2 years. If you can see the light at daybreak, you don't care if you die at dusk. It's so many people never seen the light at all. I was fumbling round, and God opened the door. Introduction. So the beginning of this was a woman, and she had come back from burying the dead. Not the dead of sick and ailing with friends at the pillow and the feet. She had come back from the sodden and the bloated, the sudden dead, their eyes flung wide open in judgment. Zora Neale Hurston, their eyes were watching God. If you ask most people what they think of when they hear the word politics, they are likely to give a definition that includes voters, parties, elections, public policy, and processes of contestation and representation. But formal participation in government is only one part of a more encompassing effort to be recognized within the nation. The struggle for recognition is the nexus of human identity and national identity, where much of the most important work of politics occurs. African American women fully embody this struggle. By studying the lives of Black women, we gain important insight into how citizens yearn for and work toward recognition. To understand Black women's politics, we must explore their often unspoken experiences of hurt, rejection, faith, and search for identity. Zora Neale Hurston's Their Eyes Were Watching God takes on the task of understanding the heart of a woman and thereby exposes meaningful political truths about hierarchy, oppression, and liberation. The goal of this book is a similar exploration. It is therefore not the kind of book you might expect from a political scientist. This book is not about Black women who hold elected office, or about the choices African-American women make in the voting booth. It is not about Black women's community organizing, protest activities, or policy choices. Rather, this book makes the claim that the internal, psychological, emotional, and personal experiences of Black women are inherently political. They are political because Black women in America have always had to wrestle with derogatory assumptions about their character and identity. These assumptions shape the social world that Black women must accommodate or resist in an effort to preserve their authentic selves and to secure recognition as citizens. This is less a book about what Black women do to become first-class American citizens than one about how they feel while they are in that struggle. A good place to start this exploration of Black women's internal politics is with the extraordinary 1937 novel, Their Eyes Were Watching God, by the anthropologist, essayist, folklorist, and playwright Zora Neale Hurston. It does not seem like an overtly political text, but in many ways it is emblematic of the racial and gender politics that we observe in contemporary American politics. Hurston's protagonist, Janie Mae Crawford, is a Black woman living in the rural South in the years after World War I. It is a classic heroic tale in which Janie confronts the distorted expectations of others and discovers her authentic self. Because Janie's journey forces her to grapple with limiting gender and race roles that constrain her, Their Eyes Were Watching God is more than a tale of achieving self-knowledge. It is a narrative that actively questions issues of power, prejudice, and human fulfillment. Hurston takes Janie on a quest for self-understanding, a quest that is expressed in her efforts to find an authentic, loving relationship in an unpredictable and threatening world where her Black womanhood makes her vulnerable to people and systems that seek to transform her into a beast of burden. As a young woman, she learns that her assigned role is to serve as a mule, carrying the weight of racial prejudice and gendered inequality. So the white man throw down the load and tell the nigger man to pick it up. He pick it up because he have to, but he don't tote it. He hand it to his women folks. The nigger woman is the mule of the world, so far as I can see. Janie's journey is a political one because it is motivated by her refusal to accept this role. As she seeks personal freedom, Janie struggles to be recognized by her grandmother, her husbands, and her community for all of who she is, and not only for the things that her embodied black womanhood represents. She survives a loveless marriage, arranged while she was still a child, and then a privileged but brutal existence with her status-conscious second husband. Ultimately, she discovers a sensual, mutually fulfilling love affair with the much younger Tea Cake. Although framed by love, this story is about more than romance. Janie must discard the limiting roles that others seek to have her fulfill. She refuses to be the world's mule, but learns how much she enjoys physical labor of her own choosing. She discovers that even if she was offered a position at the top of a hierarchy, she prefers egalitarian interactions. Janie learns to express her own wit and intelligence, even if her ideas disappoint or scandalize others. In the end, she learns that she must preserve herself, even if doing so is painful. These lessons are as much about the collective struggles of black women seeking their own freedom as they are about an individual black woman's quest to find fulfillment. As the text draws to its climax, Hurston places Janie at the center of a storm. Janie and Tea Cake are living in a town in the Florida Everglades. Their life is marked by poverty and hard work, but also by companionship and community. In their second season there, they listen as Native Americans predict a major storm and watch as they begin to leave for higher ground. Soon others evacuate too, but Janie, Tea Cake, and their friend Motorboat are among those who decide to stay and ride out the storm. That night and the next day, the storm builds. They huddled closer and stared at the door. They didn't use another part of their bodies, and they didn't look at anything but the door. The time was past for asking the white folks what to look for through that door. Six eyes were questioning God. The wind came back with triple fury and put out the light for the last time. They sat in company with the others in other shanties, their eyes straining against crude walls and their souls asking if he meant to measure their puny might against his. They seemed to be staring at the dark, but their eyes were watching God. Finally, the dikes of Lake Okeechobee burst and the waters begin to overtake the town. Janie and Tea Cake try to flee. They must swim past drowned animals, dead bodies, and massive destruction. Janie is attacked by a rabid dog and saved by Tea Cake. At last they reach the city of Palm Beach, where chaos and destruction await them. Tea Cake is forced to assist in clearing the bodies of the dead. The work is not only vile and difficult, but also profoundly racist. White corpses are given coffins, while black ones are left in a mass grave covered with quicklime. The racial hierarchy, made obvious during the storm when whites occupied high ground while forcing blacks into the dangerous, low-lying land below, is reinforced by these burials. For today's readers, Hurston's flood evokes the devastation of New Orleans in the aftermath of Hurricane Katrina. In the years since the storm, Hurricane Katrina has become a familiar metaphor, a fashionable tool by which media commentators measure every political catastrophe faced by a presidential administration. Because catastrophes like Katrina focus public attention, reveal institutional shortcomings, and evoke powerful emotional responses, they are easily reduced to casual metaphor. But I want us to try to recapture the initial horror of the tremendous human loss and emotional trauma caused by the storm. Before Hurricane Katrina, New Orleans was a place where, like Janie in the Everglades, many Black people lived with poverty and struggle, but also with community and with deep historical and familial connections, and where they made distinctive cultural contributions. This unique Black community was severely damaged in August 2005. The order to evacuate came fewer than 24 hours before the hurricane made landfall. On the day of the evacuation order, more than 1 in 4 individuals in New Orleans lived below the federally defined poverty line, and more than a quarter of New Orleans residents did not own private vehicles. As the storm approached, more than 30,000 people fled to shelters in the city's Superdome and Convention Center. Those who lacked the resources to get themselves or their families out were forced, like Janie, Tea Cake, and Motorboat, to endure the storm in their homes. New Orleans was spared a direct hit, and the city might have swiftly recovered from the extensive but manageable damage caused by wind and rain. Yet in the hours after the storm passed, several critical levees failed. As in Hurston's novel, the broken levees unleashed lake waters with frightening force and speed. In vulnerable neighborhoods, there was little warning and no means of escape. Stranded, the people waited for relief and rescue that, for days, did not come. The power went out and the floodwaters rose. Food and water became scarce. The city's shelters became centers of disease, hunger, and death. For 3 days, the victims of the storm were left to manage on their own. As they waited, President George W. Bush shared a birthday cake with Senator John McCain, visited a senior citizen's home, gave a speech on the war in Iraq, and played the guitar with a popular country singer. Secretary of State Condoleezza Rice shopped for shoes in New York City and took in a Broadway show. FEMA director Michael Brown sent lighthearted inter-office emails about which shirt and tie he should wear during his live television appearances about the disaster. Despite aggressive and continuing coverage of the destruction on cable news, it seemed that federal government officials refused to recognize what was happening in New Orleans. The contrast between the urgency of the disaster and the paucity of the initial response led many observers to question what caused this inability to see what was happening. As in Hurston's novel, the storm was a dispassionate and impersonal force, but its destruction was not shared equally. Before the storm, New Orleans was a predominantly African-American city, and those left in the wake of the hurricane were disproportionately Black. Almost exclusively, it was the suffering of Black people that was broadcast to a national viewing audience. Poor and Black citizens found themselves both more vulnerable to the disaster and less able to recover in its aftermath. Even in the earliest days of the disaster, observers began to note the obvious racial inequality. During a live broadcast on CNN, Representative John Lewis, a senior member of the Congressional Black Caucus, asserted that race was a critical factor influencing both media representations of the disaster and the responses of government officials. Lewis first gained national recognition decades earlier when he was brutally beaten while participating in a voting rights march in Selma, Alabama. The Bloody Sunday demonstration was the catalyst leading to passage of the 1965 Voting Rights Act. Throughout his distinguished career, Lewis has enjoyed a certain moral authority on issues of race. His fierce advocacy of domestic civil rights issues and his stance on international human rights concerns have earned him numerous awards, including the NAACP Spin Gone Medal and the John F. Kennedy Profile in Courage Award for Lifetime Achievement. Even Republican opponents like John McCain have written of Lewis as an American of great integrity. In the immediate aftermath of Katrina, Lewis suggested that government officials were reacting inadequately because they considered the lives of Black people unworthy of resources and action. The same argument was made more memorably on September 2, 2005, during a benefit concert. During a live broadcast on NBC, hip-hop artist Kanye West went off script, turned to the cameras, and said, "I hate the way they portray us in the media. You see a Black family, it says they're looting. You see a white family, it says they're looking for food. And you know, it's been 5 days waiting for federal help because most of the people are Black. And even for me to complain about it, I would be a hypocrite because I've tried to turn away from the TV because it's too hard to watch. We already realize a lot of people that could help are at war right now, fighting another way. And they've given them permission to go down and shoot us. George Bush doesn't care about Black people." These comments churned up a second storm as members of the media, government, and military all sought to deny that race had played any part in the response. The racial aspects of the disaster became a flashpoint for disagreement between Black and white Americans. More than 5 years later, George W. Bush recalled that the moment West accused his administration of racist neglect of Katrina survivors was the low point of his presidency. Yet even as government officials made their denials, Black Americans grew increasingly convinced that their government had abandoned them. In the days immediately following the flooding, a Pew Research Center public opinion survey revealed an enormous racial divide. While most Americans, 58%, felt depressed about the suffering caused by the storm, there were significant differences in how Blacks and whites understood the failure to rescue survivors. 70% of African American respondents reported being angry, but only 46% of whites were angry. Further, over two-thirds of Black respondents, 71%, versus only 32% of whites, believe that responses to the disaster show that racial inequality is still a major problem. A full 66% of Blacks believe that the government would have responded faster if the victims were white, while only 17% of whites agreed. The entire nation grieved over the losses in New Orleans, but for Black America, the aftermath of Hurricane Katrina forced the question of whether Black people were truly American citizens worthy of fair treatment, swift response, and unchallenged rescue. For Black Americans, the disastrous consequences of wind and water were deepened by the initially slow and then surprisingly militaristic response to Black suffering. Black Americans bristled as tens of thousands of African American men, women, and children were labeled refugees by the U.S. media, as if the disaster had occurred not on American soil, but in a distant country. The refugee label had the effect of rhetorically removing Black victims from national responsibility, as though the consequences of the levee failure were to be endured by foreigners rather than by Americans at the bottom of the same hierarchies of race and wealth that had contributed significantly to the disaster itself. As in Hurston's novel, It was these embedded racial wealth inequalities that allowed more white New Orleanians to evacuate before the storm, to return swiftly to the city, and to rebuild in the months following the storm. As it was for Janie and Tea Cake in their hurricane, white residents in New Orleans occupied high ground while blacks sought refuge in the more dangerous territory below. And just as in Hurston's novel, racial hierarchies had life and death consequences. In Their Eyes Were Watching God, Tea Cake and Janie finally find their way back home after the storm has subsided. Even then, they are not safe. Tea Cake was bitten by a rabid dog while saving Janie, and he ultimately succumbs to madness and delusions. Janie must shoot him to save her own life. Stories from New Orleans in the first days of the flood echo this plot element as well. Despite the baffling silence of the federal government and the unanswered cries for help, initial media coverage focused on criminal activity rather than on massive human suffering. Left without adequate medical supplies, food, or water, New Orleanians tried to fend for themselves by taking necessary items from stores and businesses. These attempts at survival in a disaster were labeled criminal and were denounced by the very government agencies that failed to provide the urgently needed relief. The governor of Louisiana, Kathleen Blanco, initially voiced her outrage at looters while remaining silent on the lack of coordinated federal response. On August 31st, CNN reported that Governor Blanco was just furious about lawlessness. "We'll do what it takes to bring law and order to our region," she pledged. On the same day, the Associated Press reported that New Orleans Mayor Ray Nagin had ordered most of the city's dramatically limited police force to halt rescue efforts and to concentrate on stopping looters who had grown more aggressive. Television news reported roving armed gangs of young black males opportunistically profiting from the tragedy. Reports suggested these men were stealing from electronic stores, raping women trapped in the evacuation centers, and trying to assassinate relief workers. Later, evidence showed that most of these young black men were organizing to assist other survivors who were unable to find supplies, the elderly, the sick, and women with children. These men were portrayed as rabid criminals, but their madness resulted from trying to save and care for their companions and fellow survivors. In this, they were like Hurston's Tea Cake. That desperate survivors were portrayed as dangerous criminals was largely a result of the racialized nature of the Katrina disaster. Americans have long connected urban African-American communities with crime. Decades of research in sociology, political science, and psychology demonstrate the facile link between blackness and criminality that exists for many Americans. In early reports, many U.S. media sources followed a traditional formula of representing black people as dangerous and criminal. Black residents were accused of looting, drug abuse, homicide, and rape during the disaster-evoked chaos. Most of these media-reported crimes were never substantiated, and later research showed that extensive pro-social behavior, not crime, was the primary response of survivors in the days following Katrina. Still, the alchemy of race and disaster produced a powerful image of chaos and crime that dominated the first news reports. In this way, Hurricane Katrina became more than an object lesson for preparing for natural disaster, overcoming massive destruction, coping with bureaucratic incompetence, questioning government responsiveness, appreciating civil society's flexibility, celebrating human resilience, or any of the other storylines that emerged in the months and years following the storm. Through its distinctive racial and political character, the debacle became a site for the contestation of black citizenship. Parnell Herbert, a New Orleanian and Katrina survivor, whose story is recorded in Overcoming Katrina, African American Voices from the Crescent City and Beyond, explains that even the visual images of Katrina told the story of black Americans laying claim to their rights as citizens. Something that really surprised me was the number of African Americans in New Orleans that had large American flags in their homes. Were they flags that once draped a loved one's casket? Why did the survivors begging for help from the U.S. military forces feel it necessary to wave the American flag as opposed to a white sheet or blood-stained towels? Herbert's observation reminds us that when they waved their nation's flag, black New Orleanians were making a specific claim of citizenship and belonging. In many ways, Hurricane Katrina can be read as Hurston's novel playing out in a contemporary moment, race and class hierarchies structuring the consequences of a natural disaster, powerful white institutions ignoring black suffering, and black men driven mad as they try to rescue others in the aftermath of the storm. But the connections go deeper than these incidental similarities. In Hurston's novel, the Everglades hurricane is a definitive event revealing the inequalities of society, but it is not the entirety of Janie's life. Similarly, the women who endured Katrina's aftermath are more than storm survivors. They are workers, mothers, daughters, aunts, pastors, doctors, friends, and congregants. Their stories begin long before August 29, 2005, and their experiences in the storm are shaped by the social positions they occupied before the levees failed. A racial analysis of the Katrina disaster has become received wisdom, but the story of this historic moment is a story not only of race, but of gender. As the disaster unfolded, black women became the main characters through whose suffering and resilience the media told the story. Just as Janie Mae Crawford is the focus of Hurston's novel, black women were at the eye of the rhetorical storm of Hurricane Katrina. It is on the bodies, minds, and lives of black women that the story of Katrina was written. Photographs of black mothers carrying their infants as they waded through filthy, chest-high water became enduring images of the disaster. Television news and popular magazines used images of desperate, frightened African-American women to dramatize the tragedy facing residents as they battled the aftermath of the hurricane with little official assistance. Their suffering became the conduit through which new conversations on race, class, and vulnerability began. They were the bridge over the deadly waters that allowed the rest of America to cross into the agonizing realization of how unequal the country remained at the dawn of the 21st century. Within 5 days of the storm, national media reports began to shift away from black men represented as looters, rapists, and snipers, and to focus instead on black women and children trapped in the city's evacuation centers. These women became the sympathetic victims of the storm. Post-Katrina New Orleans, as read through the lens of Hurston's novel, is a place to begin taking seriously the idea that black women's experiences act as a democratic litmus test for the nation. Legal scholars Lonnie Guinier and Gerald Torres offered the useful metaphor of the miner's canary for understanding how the political and economic realities of marginal populations indicate the democratic and economic health of the nation. Miners used canaries with sensitive respiratory systems to alert them to poisonous gases in the atmosphere of the mine. In a similar manner, vulnerable communities of Black and Brown Americans foreshadow the underlying problems likely to poison the U.S. system. In August 2005, Black women of New Orleans became the nation's miners' canary. Issues of race, gender, and class inequality that affect Black women's lives in America point to problems embedded in the fabric of the nation. Katrina rendered those inequalities highly visible. Inadequate evacuation capacity pointed to America's failure to invest in modern public transportation systems. The levee failure was indicative of America's crumbling infrastructure. The delayed government response was a sign of the limitations of federalism and a harbinger of compromised homeland security. The grinding urban poverty revealed by the storm was prophetic of impending economic crisis. The disproportionate burden of the disaster shouldered by African American women was a symbol of the brutal intersections of race, class, and gender that Black women confront daily. The 19th and 20th century educator Anna Julia Cooper wrote, "Only the Black woman can say when and where I enter, in the quiet, undisputed dignity of my womanhood, without violence and without suing or special patronage, then and there the whole race enters with me. It is African American women surviving at the nexus of racialized, gendered, and classed disprivilege who mark the progress of the nation." In the 1970s, the African American women of the Combahee River Collective recognized their continuing position, writing, "If Black women were free, it would mean that everyone else would have to be free, since our freedom would necessitate the destruction of all the systems of oppression." At the start of the 21st century, as the floodwaters rose in New Orleans, the lives of Black women once again stood for America's failures to achieve its dream of democratic equality. Hurston's Janie undertakes a voyage of self-understanding, romance, psychic exploration, and communal struggle that represents something larger than her personal story. So, too, do the images and experiences of Black women trapped by the flood in New Orleans represent the broader political reality of race, gender, class, and vulnerability in the American state. Under the headline, "Pray for Us," the September 12, 2005 cover of Newsweek featured a distressed Black woman carrying an infant and a toddler as she raced for an evacuation bus. The caption read, "A Katrina refugee and her two children." The Economist, the same week, displayed a weeping Black woman in a New Orleans t-shirt under the headline, "The Shaming of America." These two magazine covers capture important elements of how depictions of Black women were used to frame the disaster. Early reports repeatedly referred to the storm survivors as refugees and asked, "How can an American city look like Mogadishu or Port-au-Prince?" Despite being discussed as though they were distant foreigners, these Black women retained the power to shame the nation through their suffering. As women and mothers, they could represent victimization in a way that male survivors could not. In a country where patriarchal norms still demand that women and children be saved first, the abandonment of poor Black mothers and their children argued that these chivalrous impulses rarely extend to African American women. They shamed the nation because the American narrative is triumphant and collective. Americans take great pride in understanding themselves as a prosperous, just, and fair nation, steeped in relative equality and uncompromised liberty. The televised deaths from dehydration of elderly black women in a major urban center did not fit this triumphant narrative. It is a dangerous enterprise to introduce this text with a journalistic account and a literary frame, because it risks reducing the massive human suffering caused by Hurricane Katrina to little more than a metaphor or literary device. More than 1,500 people died in the aftermath of Katrina. More than 500,000 were permanently displaced. Billions of dollars of property was damaged. Entire communities were wiped away. Homes, schools, churches, and stores were irreparably damaged. Decades of family memories were lost. Centuries of traditions were altered in moments. Years after the storm, the city of New Orleans continues to struggle with the blight, economic devastation, and personal suffering induced by the levee breach. To try to understand the consequences of Katrina through a Harlem Renaissance novel is to risk a dangerous mediation of experience that makes already vulnerable persons into little more than characters in a story. Despite these dangers, there is something important to be gained from understanding this experience through the lens of fiction. Literary parallels can reveal truths that might otherwise be obscured. That is why I begin this work of social science with a work of fiction. Literature crafts a specific story to reveal a universal truth. I want to make a claim for Janie, as well as for the individual black women whom Janie represents, as an appropriate subject for the study of broader phenomena. It is important to understand political processes through the vulnerable human lives that are part of the larger story. By Henry Louis Gates' reading, Their Eyes Were Watching God does its most important political work by subverting our expectations of what counts as political. Like Hurston, I hope to disrupt our assumptions about the study of politics by beginning my investigation of contemporary American politics in the hearts and minds of ordinary black women. This book is not a work of history, but it relies on black women's history as a frame for understanding contemporary politics. It is not a work of literary criticism, but it relies on literature written by and about black women. It is not a biography, but it gives some black women an opportunity to tell parts of their personal stories. It is not a traditional social science text, but it makes use of empirical data. This book is concerned with understanding the emotional realities of black women's lives in order to answer a political, not a personal, question. What does it mean to be a black woman and an American citizen? Black women are rarely recognized as archetypal citizens. Just as many of Hurston's critics were unwilling to acknowledge Janie's exploration of her psychic reality as politically important, so have political observers largely failed to consider what we can learn about American politics by exploring the psychology of black women. This book is intended to correct that deficiency. I use the lived experiences of African-American women as my point of departure for understanding democratic citizenship in the United States. I will provide empirical evidence that the internal worlds of black women are both constituted by and influential in the political realities in which they live. African-American women face unique expectations as citizens of the United States. The particular histories of slavery, Jim Crow, urban segregation, racism, and patriarchy that are woven into the fabric of American politics have created a specific citizenship imperative for African American women, a role and image to which they are expected to conform. We can call this image the strong black woman. It defines the mantle that the nation, black communities, and black women themselves expect African American women to assume. The social construction of black women's citizenship and identity around the theme of self-sacrificial strength is a recurrent motif in black women's lives and politics. The strong black woman is easily recognizable. She confronts all trials and tribulations. She is a source of unlimited support for her family. She is a motivated, hard-working breadwinner. She is always prepared to do what needs to be done for her family and her people. She is sacrificial and smart. She suppresses her emotional needs while anticipating those of others. She has an irrepressible spirit that is unbroken by a legacy of oppression, poverty, and rejection. Over the course of this book, I will offer a theory of how the strong black woman came to function as a racial and citizenship imperative for black women. I believe that the construct of the strong black woman does not arise from empirical observation of who black women actually are. Instead, it is a racial and political construct emanating from the expectations of African American communities and from the needs of the nation that frame black women in very narrow ways. In the language of political theorists, the strong black woman myth is a misrecognition of African American women, but it creates specific expectations for their behavior within the American polity. I first set out a theory of recognition as it relates to contemporary African American women. Then I explore the history of intentional misrecognition of black women. Next, I discuss how these misrecognitions contribute to pervasive experiences of shame for black women, and try to understand how shame limits the opportunities for African American women as political and thought leaders. Finally, I claim that the imperative of impervious strength is, in part, a shame management strategy that has both emotional and political consequences for black women. Like Hurston's novel, this book is not only a story of achieving personal fulfillment, but a call for the creation of new forms of politics rooted in a deep and textured understanding of black women's lives. Empirical social science can illuminate the human experience of politics by forcing us to think about what it means to black women when they seek to fulfill the responsibilities and access the rights of citizenship. This book uses statistical, experimental, and qualitative data to draw out these meanings. It also relies on black feminist traditions that emphasize individual biographies and fictional narratives as entryways to understanding collective race and gender experiences. Hurston concludes her novel with Janie alone, but self-possessed. She has survived personal attacks, rejection, and violence. She has also survived the impersonal, chaotic destruction of the hurricane. We are left with Janie pulling the world around her shoulders. She pulled in her horizon like a great fishnet, pulled it in from around the waist of the world, and draped it over her shoulder. So much of life in its meshes. She called in her soul to come and see. Their eyes were watching. God never articulates an explicitly political role for Janie. Instead of leading a community or movement, Janie chooses a solitary and contemplative life, but she is not entirely alone. The novel consists of Janie's retelling of her story to her sympathetic girlfriend, Phoebe, knowing that Phoebe will share the story with other women in town. Although Hurston does not tell us exactly what Phoebe does with Janie's story, we do learn that by listening to Janie, Phoebe comes to feel 10 feet taller. We know that she plans to return home to her husband and demand to be treated more equally. Phoebe's task is to hear Janie's story, be made taller by it, and use it to demand changes in the systems of racism and patriarchy that circumscribe American life. She challenges us because we, as readers, are in the same position relative to Janie. We have heard the story, and it is our job to make politics out of it. The book in your hands is not so much Janie's story as Phoebe's. The Bridge Poem by Kate Rushin. This Bridge Called My Back is a groundbreaking anthology of writing by women of color. Edited by Cherie Morega and Gloria Anzaldúa, this sweeping collection of poetry, essays, and analytic pieces gathers the voices of Black, Latina, and Native American women whose identities have forced them to the margins of the racial, ethnic, and white women's movements of the previous decades. These works challenge patriarchy, misogyny, homophobia, and racism. This Bridge Called My Back is a foundational text of third wave feminism. In it, poet Kate Rushin's The Bridge Poem articulates the burdens many African American women experience as a result of attempting to fulfill multiple competing roles that serve the needs of others more than themselves. I've had enough. I'm sick of seeing and touching both sides of things, sick of being the damn bridge for everybody. Nobody can talk to anybody without me, right? I explain my mother to my father to my little sister to my brother to the white feminist to the Black church folks, the Black church folks to the ex-hippies to the Black separatists to the artists to my friend's parents. Then I've got to explain myself to everybody. I do more translating than the goddamn UN. Forget it. I'm sick of it. I'm sick of filling in your gaps, sick of being your insurance against the isolation of your self-imposed limitations, sick of being the crazy at your holiday dinners, sick of being the odd one at your Sunday brunches, sick of being the sole Black friend to 34 individual white people. Find another connection to the rest of the world. Find something else to make you legitimate. Find some other way to be political and hip. I will not be the bridge to your womanhood, your manhood, your humanness. I'm sick of reminding you not to close off too tight for too long. I'm sick of mediating with your worst self on behalf of your better selves. I am sick of having to remind you to breathe before you suffocate your own full self. Forget it. Stretch or drown. Evolve or die. The bridge I must be is the bridge to my own power. I must translate my own fears, mediate my own weaknesses. I must be the bridge to nowhere but my true self, and then I will be useful. 1. Crooked Room. The master's tools will never dismantle the master's house. Audre Lorde. Zora Neale Hurston writes Janie Mae Crawford as an irrepressibly independent woman. Janie leaves the economic security of her emotionally deadening first marriage to pursue adventure and love. After the death of her second husband, she flouts social convention and follows her heart into an affair with a much younger man. When her beloved descends into madness and threatens her life, she kills him rather than allow him to destroy her. When she is ready to return home, she does so despite the whispers and scandal occasioned by her unconventional choices. By following this path, Janie does not avoid pain, loss, and disappointment. But by choosing her own burdens rather than allowing the burdens of others to be heaped on her back, Janie refutes her grandmother's prophecy that black women are the mules of the world. Janie's quest is about carving out a life that suits her authentic desires rather than conforming to the limiting, often soul-crushing expectations that others have of her. In this way, her personal journey is a model of the struggle many black women face. This struggle is interestingly mirrored in the post-World War II cognitive psychology research on field dependence. Field dependence studies show how individuals locate the upright in a space. In one study, subjects were placed in a crooked chair in a crooked room and then asked to align themselves vertically. Some perceived themselves as straight only in relation to their surroundings. To the researchers' surprise, some people could be tilted by as much as 35 degrees and report that they were perfectly straight simply because they were aligned with images that were equally tilted. But not everyone did this. Some managed to get themselves more or less upright, regardless of how crooked the surrounding images were. When they confront race and gender stereotypes, black women are standing in a crooked room, and they have to figure out which way is up. Bombarded with warped images of their humanity, some black women tilt and bend themselves to fit the distortion. It may be surprising that some gyrate half naked in degrading hip-hop videos that reinforce the image of black women's lewdness. It may be shocking that some black women actors seem willing to embody the historically degrading image of Mammy by accepting movie roles where they are cast as the nurturing caretakers of white women and children. It may seem inexplicable that a respected black woman educator would stamp her foot, jab her finger in a black man's face, and scream while trying to make a point on national television, thereby reconfirming the notion that black women are irrationally angry. To understand why black women's public actions and political strategies sometimes seem tilted in ways that accommodate the degrading stereotypes about them, it is important to appreciate the structural constraints that influence their behavior. It can be hard to stand up straight in a crooked room. The subtitle of this book is an adaptation of Intozaki Shange's Koria poem, For Colored Girls Who Have Considered Suicide When the Rainbow Is Enough. For Colored Girls is a definitive artistic, visual, and poetic representation of the experience of the crooked room. It has sold more than 100,000 copies. The play was first produced off-Broadway in 1975. The next year, it became a Broadway production, and in 1977, it earned an Obie Award for Distinguished Production and a Tony Award for Best Featured Actress. The official publication, production, and awards history does not capture the meaning of this piece for African American women. Since its introduction more than 30 years ago, For Colored Girls has been a mainstay in the personal libraries of African American women, of black feminist curriculum, and of black women's local theater productions. Literary scholar Salamisha Tillett describes it as the Black Feminist Bible, and author Intozaki Shange observes, "Not a day goes by when some young woman somewhere Is it doing a For Colored Girls monologue, making the voice her own, finding her own infinite beauty once again? Shange's piece viscerally depicts the crooked room that black women confront. The production portrays the harshest and most bitter experiences of black women's lives. Her characters suffer sexual and romantic betrayal, abuse, rape, illegal abortion, heartbreak, and rejection. For Colored Girls has lasting significance for so many because it presents black women's experiences with unflinching rawness that is not primarily concerned with translating these experiences for a broader audience. Its primary goal is to give voice to black women by acknowledging the challenges they face, not to invoke pity or even empathy either from black men or from white viewers. It speaks to and about black women, and it does so by using language, images, and experiences that resonate for black women. For many who love it, reading or seeing Shange's For Colored Girls is like noticing not that one is alone in the crooked room, but rather that there are others standing bent, stooped, or surprisingly straight. It is an experience of having someone make visible the slanted images that too frequently remain invisible. The poems were addressing situations that bridged our secret, unspoken longing. For Colored Girls still is a women's trip, and the connection we can make through it with each other and for each other is to empower us all. Shange's work exposes the fragility of black women's emotional lives and insists that the agony of their experiences is collective, structural, and not of their own making, but it is not exclusively an exploration of victimization. Though her characters know pain, they also know love, passion, exploration, joy, music, and dance. Despite the incredible obstacles they face, not all of her women are irreparably broken. Results from the psychological studies of the crooked room show that many respondents did find a way to discern the true upright position, even when everything around them was distorted. Hurston's account of Janie Mae Crawford in Their Eyes Were Watching God is a literary example of this ability to find the upright, as is Shange's final poem in For Colored Girls, A Laying On of Hands. Black women's political history is similarly filled with examples of this independence. Black women of the early 20th century club movement resisted the lie of black promiscuity by leading a movement for temperance, modesty, and respectability. African American domestic workers resisted the idea of mammy-like devotion to whites by living outside their employers' homes, protesting unfair labor conditions, and nurturing their own families and communities. Women of the civil rights movement helped change the country, not through angry violence, but through disciplined endurance of racist counterattacks against their nonviolent struggle. These women managed to stand straight despite the crooked world in which they lived. Sometimes black women can conquer negative myths, sometimes they are defeated, and sometimes they choose not to fight. Whatever the outcome, we can better understand sisters as citizens when we appreciate the crooked room in which they struggle to stand upright. In the next several chapters, I will pose a number of questions about how black women's politics is affected by the crooked images they encounter. Is it possible that black women's organizing efforts and public reactions to issues of sexual assault are linked to their beliefs about the stereotype of black women's promiscuity? Does the pervasive notion of mammy help explain why black women are suspicious of coalitions with white women? Do black women often defer to black men's religious, familial, and political leadership because they reject the idea that they are angry and domineering? Having a clear view of the distorted images and painful stereotypes that make America a crooked room for African American women is the first step toward understanding how these stereotypes influence Black women as political actors. To learn more about the titled images of the crooked room that contemporary Black women encounter in the United States, I conducted focus groups with 43 African American women in Chicago, New York, and Oakland. As a warm-up task, I asked participants to think about Black women as a group and list the stereotypes or myths about them that other people may hold. I then asked them to write down the facts about Black women as they saw them. They worked in groups and had very lively discussions about both the myths and the facts. Although these women lived in different cities, were of several generations, and had different economic and family circumstances, their discussions formed a coherent picture. They independently arrived at the same three stereotypes that many researchers of African American women's experience also identify: Mammy, Jezebel, and Sapphire. Like the women in the focus groups, some listeners will find these stereotypes familiar. Others may never have heard of these myths, and still others may not know the negative connotations attached to them. In the next chapter, I will explore the historical and contemporary outlines of the three stereotypes at length, but for the purposes of understanding the general idea of the crooked room, here I offer the brief explanations given by the women in the focus groups. For those of you less familiar with these ideas, I ask you to trust me for a little while longer that Mammy, Jezebel, and Sapphire are common and painful characterizations of Black women, and that each has a long history in American social and cultural life. As they identified the main stereotypes, the focus group participants said that Black women are seen either as oversexed or as fat mammies who aren't thinking about sex at all. There was broad agreement that white people generally saw them as either promiscuous or asexual. Jezebel, maid, and mammy were the terms they used most often to label these stereotypes. Margaret, a 52-year-old woman from the West Beverly neighborhood of Chicago, said, "Just because we are African, we're supposed to be wild and all this. We are supposed to be from the jungle and like to have wild sex, like that is all we think about. Folks think we're hot to trot, or they think we're Aunt Jemima. It's never in between." Many talked about the welfare queen as an ever-present characterization, although nearly all the women rejected the hypersexual and mammy stereotypes, several agreed with the welfare queen myth. "That is not a myth," one participant said.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.